Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the Rangers Review morning briefing. It is Friday, the 8th of November. I'm Derek Clark, and I'm joined this morning by Stevie Clifford. How's it going, Stevie?
Yeah, I'm very good. Good morning, everyone. Very good result and performance last night, Derek. So, yeah, nice to be on and talk about something positive.
Yep, Rangers earning a point over in Greece against Olympiacos after falling behind to a second half goal. Cyril Dessers put several missed opportunities behind them to fire Rangers level, and that is how it finished against Olympiacos. Rangers now on 7 points after their opening four matches in the Europa League, four matches to come. Got Nice away from home at the end of the month, followed by that home clash against Tottenham, then trip to Old Trafford in the new year, culminating with the match against Union Saint-Gilloise at Ibrox to round off the campaign. Stevie, before we delve right into the detail from the game, I said it before, I would have bitten your hand off for a point last night, but perhaps Rangers a little bit unfortunate not to take all three.
After going behind, I am very pleased to get a point. And yeah, I would have taken a point. Absolutely would have taken a point. But it was more, you know what, Derek? It was more overall the performance for me that pleased me so much. And yeah, look, absolutely fantastic to get a result. I know that. I'm not silly if they perform well and not got a result, etc. But when you give me that level of determination, attitude, and work great, then it's going to please me every time. And I thought they gave us that attitude and desire was spot on from the very beginning. So, yeah, really, really pleased. And it's a massive point when you think about it. You know, four away from six in the away games is quite the return. Lyon, you can kind of write off much the same way as Spurs and Man United. You can kind of write them off as well. So it's really down to two games now for me, Nice away and Saint-Gilloise at home. So you got a real opportunity. And I think that the performance and the result is something to build on. So yeah, really pleased.
Plenty to discuss. So we'll get stuck right in. So the teams were announced, Stevie. There was a surprise. We all called for Dejan Sterling to get the nod at right back. And that is what happened. It was taken off around just after the 51 minute mark. It's not believed to be an injury of any kind. It's just managing his minutes, and the ratio Casemiro coming on at right back. This is what the manager had to say about not starting James Tavernier in the game last night.
The decision wasn't to leave your captain out of the starting 11 tonight.
That's never an easy decision, but I want more than one captain in the group. And it's also, if you come at a certain age, you cannot play 60 games anymore at the same level. So that's normal. So we knew that before the season. We talked about that before the season also. And that was just the captain. So he will continue like that, and he will play also more games this season. And it's about competition for the spots for everybody. It's not about one player or one ego or one thing. It's about one team. It's about winning together. And he showed it also now in the last couple of weeks also by playing in a higher position in moments and doing the job for the team. So that's what I expect. That's Rangers. One team, one family, everybody going for one goal.
So that's what the manager had to say on that, Stevie. Big call. It was a big decision to remove him at the weekend against Motherwell with Rangers chasing a winner. And he never started him yesterday. What do you make of his comments there?
I'm trying not to read too much into them. And, you know, you could, when he talks about egos and things, you know, people might pounce upon that word. But look, for me, it all boils down to one thing. Was it the correct decision? The answer is yes, it was. And it proved it on Sunday against Motherwell, and it proved it last night that Rangers are far stronger when Dejan Sterling or Casavirzo is it right back. Both of them are more athletic. Both of them have got more physical kind of power behind them. And yeah, I mean, listen, I think that James Tavernier has been an outstanding servant for Rangers. I really do. But like all things, Derek, you know, time kind of catches up with you a wee bit, and that's what's happened. I thought Sterling defensively was excellent. He offered a really good out ball for us in the first half as well from goal kicks. He was winning a lot of headers to Tierney and a lot of balls to Tierney. And then I thought it was strange to bring on Casavirzo when he did at that point. But it turned out to be a really good decision because I thought he was excellent as well. So I'm not going to write off James Tavernier yet, but I think that what we're seeing is now a transition away from James Tavernier as being first choice right back. And it's maybe, Derek, 3-4 months later than it should have been, but I don't blame the manager for giving James that opportunity. He deserves at least that opportunity. I think that's come and gone now, and I think that Rangers as a whole are better when he's not in the team. Sorry if that upsets people. But likewise, I think they're better when Tom Morris isn't in the team, as you seen last night also, because they're more athletic and they're able to do more things, able to push higher, they're able to press more. There's more energy in the team than when they two are in it. So, listen, it's not a personal thing. It's just my opinion and how I see it. And I thought that starting Dujon and then bringing on Casavirzo last night was entirely the correct decision, and it worked. So the manager at the end of the day, as much as he's got a loyalty and everything else, the players understand that. At the end of the day, he's playing for his own future, Derek. So maybe the penny's dropped a wee bit with him in terms of his selections also. So it's a difficult one, but it is the right one.
It certainly looks that way to me. Big thanks to Ricky. He says that you're losing your laptop, Mike, not the external. Yeah, thank you, Ricky. I've now changed. The cable's a little bit sensitive here, so I must have kicked it out prior to it coming on air. Right, other big things to note. The midfield, Stevie, I thought that the Raskin-Barron partnership was brilliant again last night. Raskin guilty of giving the ball away at times in that first half, but the pair of them, like they were against the FCSB, and they have been recently domestically as well. They get everywhere across the park, the little bulldogs in there. This is what Raskin had to say, incidentally, about being deployed as the Rangers' number six in front of the back four.
Happy to play now as a six. I think my collaboration with Connor is good. We love to work together to get the ball back for the team. We had some good spell with Tom. Now Dio came in. You can see Dio is a great player. I think we've got loads of good players in the midfield. If I think of Kieran, Cole McKinnon. So we can only look forward and think, like, improve all together to enjoy games like that.
Nico, do you feel like you speak about number six, you're brought in to play that role, you've had a couple of injuries. Is that the position where you can play your best football, do you think, that number six role that we're seeing in at the moment?
If you ask me, I would say I love to play as a six, to help defensively and to try to give the ball to my 10 or my 8 or the winger. But like I said, you know, in football you have to play whatever the team needs you. So I'm trying to give my best every time. I know it's not been every time perfect, but I'm trying to give my best. And then, you know, there is a game like that you can enjoy and just now it's time to recover because then they've got another game, important game. So, yeah.
Brilliant. Really enjoying that partnership, Stevie. As a comment comes in from Darren, it says, first proper midfield partnership in a while. What have you made of those two?
Terrific. I thought bulldogs in that midfield was an apt description of them. So I've spoke about this before. It's one of my favourite little stats. The average recovery in a league game for a midfielder or anybody in the team is 6. It's 5.9 or something. Say 6. Raskin last night was 16 and Connor Barron was 8. And that shows you the recovery levels of both of them. And Connor Barron had a major part to play in the goal, which shouldn't be kind of downplayed because he's able to slightly push. Now, he done this against Bucharest and made Egerman's goal, and he'd done it last night. He managed to get a wee toe poke and panicked him a wee bit, and then the boy passed it straight to Tierney. So both of them, I thought, were terrific. Nico Raskin in the first half an hour night, I said this on socials as well, needed to calm down a wee bit. He was rushing it a lot, and it was nice that he actually came out and said, I needed to calm down a wee bit and I was rushing it. So he understands it as well. I think he's a terrific wee player. His attitude's brilliant. Likewise, so is Conor Barron. The amount of effort they put in for the team. And the challenge now is what I said, you know, last week, and what I'll continue to say for them too, is that they need to consistently show they're capable. They've got a real opportunity, Derek, of becoming the two in midfield steady for a good while for Rangers, and that not changing. And yes, there'll be moments where they come off in games half an hour early, etc. Hopefully, when we're able to do that, and I get that completely. But both of them, particularly in there, have been absolutely great. So when we're all crying out for that six, Nico Raskin's taken his opportunity. He actually wrote about it, I think, just before the Kilmarnock game, and we know that obviously turned out to be ill-fated, but it's time for people to stand up and take their opportunities. And I feel like they too have. And in fairness, Barron's been consistently good this season. And he maybe just needed that. And he's got it now in a partner. So I think both of them complement each other really well. And enjoying watching them. And even when you look at Raskin last night, Diamandé loses it. And he just takes a foul on the 94th minute, knowing full well that it's better than letting him progress. Mm-hmm. And it's really quite smart at times. So I want to add that I thought Diamandé was excellent. The amount of running and pressure and kind of takes the ball in tight places and things like that he does is really unnoticed at times. And he's a world of difference away in terms of energy and athleticism to Tom Lawrence, who's a different kind of player. Tom Lawrence is more, you know, a second striker type of player, but he doesn't track and run the way that Diamandé does. And yes, look, the three of them at times can be better on the ball, but when you've got that energy in midfield, Derek, it'll take you a long way. And I think that, you know, it's certainly benefiting. All of a sudden, it feels like Bayrami and Tierney are dangerous when you're looking at them too as well. And it feels like, you know, with Diamandé in there, that they get the ball more often and things like that. So you've got the basis of something there. And they need to prove it. You know, we need a lot more consistency, and we need a long spell of performances before we can actually say, yeah, these two boys are in there and they're answering things like that. But in terms of, you know, giving us a wee bit of hope in there, they were both absolutely terrific. And as I said, recoveries between the pair of them was top class.
Yep. Let's get to a few of the comments. First of all, Peggy says, big shout out to Donna. It's her birthday today. Happy birthday, Donna. Yeah, big fan of the show. Happy birthday, Donna. Hopefully you have a fantastic day. Bill Story with the points is not quite at the same level, but we throw back to McCall Ferguson days. What a midfield duo those were. Yeah, a long, long way to go before we can consider them in that bracket. But yeah, I can understand the sort of likeness, sort of terrier bulldog fashion, winning the ball. Love to have it. I sure McCauley and Ferguson players in their prime at this moment in time at Rangers. Terrific players. At this point, I wanted to pick up on just hearing from Raskin there, Stevie. John Adams with a point. Interesting, he mentioned Cole McKinnon. That must be a positive for the young lad. Raskin talking about him as a squad player. He's been on the fringes, of course. I think he certainly surprised me last season when the manager brought him on as a sub against Benfica away. And then you think, oh, this could be a real chance for him to push on. But he hasn't really done that, Cole McKinnon. But certainly Raskin name-checking him there, he must be banging on the door, surely.
Well, it's a fitness thing for Cole, I think. Mm-hmm. Runs out of contract at the end of the season, so it's a big few months for him about whether or not he's going to, you know, he'll be looking to stay, and he'll be looking for more first-team action, I think. And in order to get that, he's got to prove it. So I think that Cole McKinnon does have the attributes there. It's about, again, proving it and taking your opportunity. And where, you know, in games, and I said this before, I'll say it again, hopefully we are in a position where Cole McKinnon can get half an hour, because he is exactly that type of player. And I remember he came on at right back in a game last year as well, and he did really well at fullback as well. So he's capable. I think Cole McKinnon, it's about him forcing his way in to get those 20 minutes, those half an hour, and taking them, because he's the sort of player that can, you know, back both those boys up and add a wee bit of kind of depth in there. So, yeah, look, it's nice of him to get name checked, but he also has to push on and prove it himself.
Yep. This reminds me, Scotty says, come on, guys, over 600 watching, only 40 odd likes. Hit the like button, please. Yeah, if you want, I know many of you, I showed the stats the other day there. Johnny showed me that those of you that watch, thousands of you watch the morning show in the morning briefing, but only half are subscribers. So hit that subscribe button as well. There's lots more content available on the channel, not just the morning briefing as well. So lots of coverage from last night. So hit that subscribe button as well. Thanks for reminding me, Scotty, on that one. Let's talk Cyril Dessers then. Stevie took his goal really well last night. See you chuckling away there. Had a pretty typical Dessers performance. Missed a couple of chances in the first half. But you've got to say, took his goal really well. Like you said earlier on, Barron had a big say in that. Olympiacos then giving the ball away cheaply. Tierney set him up. He puts it the defender on his backside before firing the ball into the corner for 1-1. What did you make of his display last night?
I don't know what to make of his displays half the time, Derek, never mind last night. But somebody texted me and said he's the reason we got a draw and he's also the reason we didn't win. And I found that quite amusing. First of all, he's offside for his first chance. Mm. But if he puts that in, there's always a question, because VAR, you never know, because the angles on the naked eye at times appear like miles off, isn't he? And then you watch it again and you're like, VAR. And so you put that in regardless, right? And that, he should score. That's probably his easiest chance. He's one-on-one, that's bread and butter. And he hits it straight at the goalkeeper. And I think he thinks he's offside. So he kind of doesn't really go for it. The second one, I know he's got criticism for it, but it's behind him. He gets a shot away. It's a decent save. It happens. And ultimately, he scored the one that you wouldn't expect him to score out of all three. His little turn, his little chop inside is terrific. And then it's a first-time finish. And we spoke earlier on in the season about he was starting to finish first time. And I think it was a 4-4 game in Germany that he had a couple out there that, you know, first time he was really good. And you're thinking, is it a composure thing? Because when he's got time, he's just, like, he doesn't finish. How many times have you seen him run through and he takes the wrong opportunity, one-on-ones, he's not very clinical. And then you have that pass when he gets away and he should play in by Rami, I think it is, on the left-hand side, and he tries to go himself with a big 30-yard drive, which isn't his kind of forte either. So, look, it was a total mixed bag, but you've got to say, like, his goal was a worldie, like, great finish, great touch inside, first touch across the goalie into the corner. It was absolutely terrific. And he's popped up with an equaliser on Sunday. He's popped up with an equaliser last night. And he's just, he's a bit of an enigma. Yeah. I've got to be honest. Like, I'm far from his biggest fan. That's reserved, obviously, to Shona, who enjoyed our moment last night.
Well chat, Stevie, be careful what you say, Stevie. I'm watching. She's a big Dessers fan.
So I just think that it's strange, isn't it, Derek? Because it was such an amazing finish, and it was. The chop inside and then the finish was terrific. But you watch other parts of his game, and it's difficult to fathom, isn't it? So maybe, with others pushing him on and things like that, it'll kick him on a wee bit. And he can score goals. And he's always fit. He's always available. He's always putting himself front and centre, regardless of the stick and the pressure he takes. And I think he knows he's under a wee bit of pressure and he's getting a wee bit of stick, because his celebration was a wee bit kind of understated last night as well. And I think it was not relief. I won't say that for the big guy, but I think he knows that he's under a wee bit of pressure, and his finish, look, was absolutely terrific. So credit to him. And then you get the other side where you're just going to just play that through for Bairami and stuff like that. And on Sunday, going to just play the through ball for Bairami again. And he's a frustrating head scratcher at times. But maybe him and Danilo can partner the way they did on Sunday. They can rotate a wee bit, and you never know. But I would just like, as we all would, just a wee bit more consistency when he's one-on-ones.
Yeah.
You know, things like that. Just talk them away. The second one, as I said, I know people have criticised it, but I think that's a good
save as well from the goalie.
A good save, yeah. But the first one, Derek, a one-on-one, come on now. You're clear of the defender. You've done everything right with your run because you've cut across him. You're rounding him. You're lifting it. You're doing anything but just firing it straight at him. Those are the ones. And even if that is offside, right, fine. If you put the ball in the net, it gives the team such a lift as well because we're capable here of scoring goals. But he played his part in what is a really fine away European performance and result. So you've got to give him credit for that, and it's certainly no problem doing that.
Yeah, I just wondered as well, watching that, I mean, Cherny did well to cut the ball back. I just wondered if he maybe should have gone for goal himself. He did. I thought he was great again last night. Vaslav Cherny, he's one that's certainly enjoying his football.
Derek, so does Bairami. Just all of a sudden, I don't know if it's a perception thing from us that are watching, because I've seen other comments last night on social saying that he looked and it felt like he was dangerous, but is it a confidence thing from the pair of them the last couple of games? I'm not sure, but Cherny certainly looked like the player that we hoped and thought he could be, and let's hope that continues in our big, big game on Sunday night as well. So, look, just got to continue. These boys pitching in with numbers and everything else, you know. It's you can see, dare I say it, and God, we've been guilty of this so many times, and I'll say it with a ton of caveats, Derek, as you know, our favourite word. There is some signs of that team being decent if you can add little bits of puzzles here and there and everything else. It's nowhere near where it should be, but there's four or five shoots of recovery, did I say it, in there. Right back. Jeffy again last night. Look, had a difficult moment on Sunday. Really, really good last night. And, yeah, I think that it's dangerous. You don't want to go over the top, right? You don't want to seem like you're going over the top on what was a really good result and things like that. But you need a consistency. So you need to go and beat Hearts. You need to return from the international break, go on a proper run and everything else. But this team, as much as they've been maligned and they really have a massive opportunity next month on a certain Sunday to turn all everything around, as massively difficult as that seems and unlikely as it seems, they have that opportunity. So it's about a level of consistency now for all of them.
Yeah, and Clement deserves credit as well. We've criticised him, I think, warranted domestically. Rangers far and away nowhere near where they should be. But in Europe, again, and that's now six away games unbeaten for him since he took over. Sparta Prague, of course, a goalless draw. The win in Betis, the draw against Benfica, that really should have been a win over there. The draw in against Kiev, of course, and then the win in Malmo, and then last night. So certainly...
2 wins away from home in 10 in Scotland, isn't it? But 6 undefeated in Europe. We know what it tells us. So, make it make sense a wee bit.
Yeah.
It wouldn't surprise me, Derek. I seen somebody yesterday at lunchtime and they said, Stevie, what do you think of tonight? And I was like, could be a win. Could easily be a defeat. You just don't know what you're going to get. And I feel more confident going to Nice than I do going to Rugby Park. It's quite frankly ridiculous.
Yeah.
But that's something for the manager to solve. And yeah, look, he does deserve credit. And also something as well, we questioned whether or not this team were playing for him. Played for him on Sunday, 1-0 down, could have chucked it at halftime.
Yep.
Roared back, got the right response. And last night, you can't tell me that those players weren't playing. And when you consider Kilmarnock, I questioned them and said, I don't think they're playing. You'll never convince me they're giving everything. Well, last night, they gave us everything. And I'm not going to read into too much of selections and everything else, but there was a freedom about their play last night. And it was really good. And when you get that level of desire and heart, then we're all going to take it every single day. All we want to do is see them give us 100%. And if they fall short, fine. We know where we are. We absolutely get it. But when you get that level of determination and desire and everything else, and then they produce that last night, we'll galvanise behind it. And it will give Clement more time. And that goes back to what we said on Sunday which people kind of picked up on, and I think Johnny said it as well, that if you make those key changes, Derek, the changes that we think, and albeit we're not coaches or anything, absolutely, think is needed, Tavernier, Lawrence, etc. If you go with others, then you will get more leeway than if you keep trying the same things that don't work. And last night, he made those changes, albeit Lawrence is enforced. Tavernier certainly not. But the performance overall of those that he brought in and the team overall reflected, and he'll get more time if he makes those big decisions, in my opinion.
Yeah, it's good to see him making them. And Sunday will be interesting to see who starts against Hearts. They were on the receiving end of a 2-0 loss last night against Heidenheim at Tynecastle. Had a number of opportunities in the first half, but failed to take them and were beaten, losing their 100% record in that Conference League as well. But they do have a new manager in Neil Critchley. I'd imagine they'll be well organised, and more so than what they were under Stephen Naismith at the start of the season. Had an absolute disastrous start. But Rangers at Ibrox, fully expecting the 3 points, surely, Stevie, going into that game. The boys should be full of confidence and belief after last night. In terms of potential alterations, are you making many changes? I know you touched on, we've discussed Dessers there. I would be tempted to start Danilo up top, I've got to say. If he's ready to play a certain amount of minutes, then I would certainly be tempted, although saying that, as you said quite rightly, Dessers has now scored 2-2. Is it the start of another rich vein of form? But how do you see Rangers setting up on Sunday?
I think probably Casavirjo comes in for Sterling, because you're watching Sterling's kind of minutes possibly, or Sterling gets 60. I think Dessers starts again. Danilo coming in again for maybe 45, maybe 30 minutes at the end of the game. And I'm not seeing too much Cherney, Bairami, Diamandi, the three start in the middle. Jeffy starts on the left. Redvan coming on at some point to get some minutes, hopefully. Central defence, probably change proper out of there. I know he did well in Europe last night, and he defended well, cleared his lines really well at times, but Europe suits him more than I think our game does up against Shankland. I would be tempted to bring in Balogun, I think. So, yeah, I mean, they're the potential changes. You wouldn't want Barron or Raskin to change in the middle, or Diamandi, no, actually, because of the amount of energy they put in. Are they likely to be able to play another 90? You're not sure. But listen, it'll be a really hard game. Again, although we did earlier on in the year, Hearts is always generally a close, tough game. Yep. Seen the first game of the season at Ibrox last year was 2-1. Two really late goals from Tab, penalty, and then Danilo as well. So, listen, it's always going to be tough, but we have to put together a domestic run, Derek. So, you know, you cannot fall any further behind. Certainly not further behind Aberdeen, that's for sure. If you discount Celtic a wee bit at the moment, you know, the gap is absolutely far too big from others. So, yeah, it's vital that we go on a consistent run, that's for sure. And it needs to start with a victory on Sunday. Then you regroup, maybe get a couple of players back. Cortez, Matondo, Redvan are all there and thereabouts now, aren't they? So you get these guys back and all of a sudden there's more options and it looks a wee bit brighter. And you never know in terms of who can come in and do what. And I know we can't rely too much on these guys, Derek, but just gives your manager more options, that's for sure. So bless you, by the way.
Yeah, thanks. I muted my mic there so you didn't have to hear that. But yeah, there we go. But yeah, our predicted teams will be out on the website tomorrow, folks. Not to give you too many spoilers, but just looking at the team last night, potential changes. I agree with you, Stevie, at centre-back. I'd be taking out Robin Proper. I'd be tempted to play Cashin Weirjo in there. I think I'd keep Sterling. This is an interesting one. Michelle with the point says Hadji. I was thinking about this this morning. Do I bring Yanis Hadji back in there to start the game? Did score for the B team earlier on in the week. I think I would be surprised if he started, but I can certainly understand why some would like to see him in that, certainly in the attacking midfield forward line. So, yep, those projected lineups, I think Chris is sending his over to me a little later on, so you can find those on the website tomorrow. But, yeah, I think the manager will make one or two alterations to the team that performed ever so well last night. Maka says, is there a presser today, Derek? No, there is not, buddy. So, no press conference today. But those of you that Rangers Review Extra members, the good news is me and Stevie will be returning this afternoon, 1:30 for our weekly Q&A show. It's been a long time since we've done one together, Stevie, so it'll be good to get back on. So what I'll do is I'll stick the link out on the community page as ever. So fire your questions in, everybody, and we'll get through as many as we possibly can. We'll wrap up with this. Sandy with a point. What do you think about the 125 years of Ibrox merch? I've bought the tweed hat. Lovely. It's absolutely fantastic, I've got to say. Kudos to Rangers and Castor for it. One thing for me, in terms of the strips, sponsors ruin it. I don't like the sponsors on there. I would have preferred a sponsorless version, but is what it is. Like the crest. Don't know why the goalkeeper jersey is not available. That doesn't make sense to me. But the merch, Stevie, you a fan or not? I think we touched on this the other day there, but there's other clothing parts associated with it. And you have a great little code that people have been taking advantage of.
Yeah, listen, the reaction yesterday. So we have our Castor affiliate partnership, Derek, as you know. And I think yesterday, 240 sales, Derek, I was able to check the kind of online, and that is just under £19,000 worth of sales for Rangers and Castor. So minimum spend is £80. The Heritage long sleeve top is £80, and it sold out on the website yesterday. So incredible response. Use our code, you get 25% off, which basically means that you are getting the top, long sleeve top for £60 instead of £80. So likewise, if you prefer the short sleeve, it's £75. Add a scarf in there, chuck in the code, which you will find on all of our social media. It's pinned code on X. Go in there and have a wee look. It's also on Four Lads Facebook page, etc. So you'll find it, the link, you'll find the code. Gets you 20% or 25% off. Great in time for Christmas as well, Derek. The amount of messages I had yesterday saying thanks so much, saved, bought a couple of tilt tops for the family, saved X amount, etc. has been brilliant. So, yeah, it's a really good offer. I don't know how long it'll be valid for, because I think that possibly Castor, you know, only let these things run for a couple of days before they kind of change it up, and they might take the heritage strip option out of it. So, but in terms of the merch, Derek, I like the wee skip cat, the wee bonnet. Yeah. So, but I don't know. Listen, I know I turned 41 a couple of weeks ago, but I don't know if I'm quite old enough yet for that. Like, I've got quite a big head, quite a big dome, Derek. So, I don't know if it would suit the old skip cat. But you know, I liked it. I must admit. I think the strip and stuff is absolutely brilliant. I love the sponsors being on it because they're very good to me and take me abroad and things, so I will never say a bad thing about them. I'm a total shill, so that's absolutely fine. And yeah, I think the Rangers have nailed it. Really disappointing that they aren't retailing the goalkeeper top, which is frustrating. I know particularly Davies is a bit upset about that, isn't he? So really frustrating at times. I don't think they're doing any children's kits either. It's just juniors it starts at, so it's a bit frustrating. But it is what it is. And hopefully people enjoy the code and stuff like that. And I would add, Derek, as well, that just for people watching, the code is not just the Heritage Tops. It's 25% off all of the online range when you spend over £80. Now, I know £80 a lot, but it's like basically only a couple of things these days you get off the online store. Also on Castor as well, we have a code for anything from Castor if anyone's looking as well. So that's another 25% off there as well. So on the run up to Christmas, get in touch if you need any of these things and we can help you out.
Yeah, spot on. Fantastic.
And all that, sorry, just to say, all of our commission, Derek, goes back to charity. We were able to donate £141 to Poppy Scotland. just on midweek there, just from last month's commission alone. And yesterday's commission, just on that one sales, was well over £400. And we hopefully will get that to cash for kids in time for Christmas next month. It depends. It takes a while for these things to kind of go, but
yeah,
we might be able to sort that in time, which would be fantastic. So to be fair to them, Castor are really helpful and really good with it all. So it helps Rangers fans and it helps charity. So we're well in for that.
Yeah, spot on. Excellent stuff. Right, folks, that'll do us there for now, of course. Big thank you to you all for tuning in to the show. As we mentioned earlier on, those of you that are extra members on the channel, we'll be back for the Q&A around about 1:30 this afternoon. We hope you can join us for that. Over on the YouTube channel just now, you can watch those press conferences. Joshua spoke to Nico Raskin in the mix zone. You can also hear from Philip Clement and John Souter. That interview dropped this morning on the channel as well, so do go and check it out. Right, we'll speak to you a little later on if we don't. Enjoy your Friday and bye for now.